Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Happy Sunday. Happy Sunday to those of you who are at home. We are so blessed to be in the house of God. We had a great time last night. We hope that if you weren't here, you were able to tune in on Zoom if it was available, because it was just such fun praising God, and we had a great band. So all of you, welcome to the house of God. We are going to kick it off with another Sunday Christmas song that you can sing along to. So if you'd like to join us, angels we have heard on high, you may stand, use your hands, smile at someone. Let us sing in excelsis Deo. He is worthy of all our praise, isn't he? You know, if you clap your hands, you warm up a bit more.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strain.
We say,
Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Come
to Bethlehem and see Him whose birth the angels see. Come adore on bended knee Christ the Lord, the newborn King.
FBC.
And the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strain,
we say,
Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Yes.
Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Oh, a son to us is born. Yes, amen. Woo. Please be seated.
Morning. Good to have you here in the house of the Lord. It's good to be here during this season of Advent and celebration. We begin today, you know, with our confession. Before the service in my office, I study and I pray. And I was praying, and God reminded me of something. You know, I was praying, oh God, you know, have people show up and bless the band and all everything that goes on and, you know, fill it with your presence. And God reminded me, he said, you know, Dennis, in a lot of ways, that's not what Sunday is about. I'm with you always. I'll always bless you and everything else. But one of the main reasons is for Sunday is for us to come together and bless God. You know, we spend this time singing praises and giving prayers and hearing His word, it's our time to give back to God, you know, set aside. So as we read, let us deal with that type of attitude of saying, God, we're here to worship you at this time of the year. So let us read our confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we earnestly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will, walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Let's pray. God, we are grateful to you for your love and your mercy, for your forgiveness, that you make us new creation, that you had this all planned out and have called us to walk in your truth. So bless us so we can bless you, God, and bless each other. In your name we pray. Amen.
Why do we light the fourth candle?
Jesus, the first candle is a reminder of the light of hope of the prophets. The second candle is a symbol of the light and warmth Joseph and Mary found in the stable. The third candle reminds us of the great light and joy which surrounded the shepherds at the angel's announcement of Jesus' birth. The fourth candle reminds us of the light of the stars in the sky which guided the wise men to Jesus and which kept watch over us by night. The story of the birth of Jesus, as Matthew wrote, in Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 through chapter 2, verse 12, Now the birth of Jesus Christ was this way. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. But Joseph, her husband-to-be, being just, was not willing to make her a public example, and he had in mind to put her away secretly. But as he thought about these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary home as your wife, for that in her is fathered by the Holy Spirit, and she shall bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins.
Now all this happened to fulfill what was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, the virgin shall conceive in her womb and will bear a son, and they will call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took his wife, did not know her until she bore her son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men came from the east to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. But when Herod the king heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea.
So it was written by the prophet, "And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are not the least among the governors of Judea, for out of you shall come a governor who shall rule my people Israel." Then Herod, when he secretly called the wise men, inquired of them exactly what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the young child. And when you have found him, bring me word again so that I may come and worship him also."
When they had heard the king, they departed. And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them until it came and stood over where the child was. And seeing the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. And they fell down and worshiped him. And opening their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. Let us pray. O God, when we think of Christmas, we think of love and lights and gifts and happy times, but we forget how concerned Joseph was and how threatened Herod felt. Thank you, God, for protecting Jesus in every situation, even bringing wise men from far away to come and worship him. You gave them exceedingly great joy. Give us also exceedingly great joy today. Help us give him our treasures and gifts and to live with great confidence in our good and powerful God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Will the congregation now stand and join us in singing We Three Kings?
Thy perfect light. And the Lord has come to be born and be with us. And it is amazing, amazing grace and love that he has shown us. Let us sing this song, Amazing Grace. Lord, this morning we remember that you are alive, mostly, importantly, in our hearts.
Yeah, yeah.
We worship you, Lord.
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Yes, that is Jesus.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Yes, all he's done for us. He came to be born. He became human. And he lived amongst us. Yes.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shine like the sun with all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Yes, you are.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place.
Lord, thank you
that you would bear my cross. Lord, you laid down your life
for me.
Oh, that I would be set free.
Truly free by you today, Lord.
Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
We're going to say that he is worthy. Say it with me.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy.
That we have been set free and redeemed. And let us say today, Hosanna, praise is rising. Let us welcome the King into this place.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you.
House, hope.
Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for you, Jesus. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day.
Anything that may come.
Oh,
Authority over all things, and if he says you've been set free, you've truly been set free. So believe it, the Lord says that you are his child, because you are.
Who am I that the highest king would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me. Yeah.
am set free. I am healed, Lord, because of your presence this morning, because of your love, your amazing grace that envelops us, and your very presence that is in this place. We feel you. It is so tangible that I can feel you in this place, Lord. You are the Lord of all, and you are with us. Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. And Merry Christmas. The readings for this morning come from Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 4, and Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. Isaiah. A shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his root, a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and of understanding, the Spirit of counsel and of might, the Spirit of the knowledge and fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes or decide by what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness, he will judge the needy. With justice, he will give decisions for the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips, he will slay the wicked. The words in Philippians. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature, God did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by being obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every other name. That the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, your love sustains us. We look to the heavens to where our help will come from. Our hope, peace, joy, and love are in us because of you. We submit ourselves to you, the one who knows. Heal what is broken in us and bless Dennis as he reveals your insight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, let's get started here. A couple reminders. Remember, December 24th is our Christmas Eve service. It's at 5:30. It's a very special service. They've kind of done some special things for it. So I invite you to not only attend, but visit, you know, friends, family, whatever, who's ever in town. I want to thank everybody for last night. If you weren't here, you missed probably one of the greatest nights of the church in the 26 years I've been here. So, but luckily, you know, you can see it on YouTube. It was recorded, but it was absolutely phenomenal. It would have been an amazing experience for you. So I will encourage you to do that. So also remember giving, year-end giving, you know, we do this every year. You know, you want tax credit in the church. We want to balance the books, just to remind you. And the last thing, I always talk about this at Christmas time, is, you know, reach out to others at this time. There's a lot of people that this is not a happy time. For most of us, it is a great time of celebration. But for some people, it's a very lonely time, and it's a hard time, and a depressive time. So people you know in the congregation and out of the congregation, especially people that are single and alone or widowed, you know, just reach out to them and give them some love during this time of the year. That's what this is all about. So, amen. So we are talking about the advent of love. We've done the other ones. Now, historically, you understand that the advent means coming. That's nothing new. And we always talk about what does that coming mean. There's really three comings that it refers to. The first one is obviously Jesus coming as a child. And that's what we celebrate on Christmas Eve and the Advent. But it also means that he's going to come back again. The church always was between these two things. You know, celebration of him coming to earth. But also, after that happened, they spent most of their time anticipating him coming back. And during the New Testament time, most of them, even Paul, until later on, expected that he would come back in their lifetime. It was later on that Paul had to change some of his thinkings and institute leadership principles and ecclesiastical organizations for the body of Christ, because it may be a while before Jesus came back. And obviously it's been 2,000 years and he's still not back. But we celebrate that truth. And then finally, we celebrate the idea of him coming now. You know, with open heavens and changed lives. I mean, every day, what we talked about before, Jesus is here. He comes to you. He lives in you. He blesses you. He protects you. He does all these things. And so celebrate these truths. It also means, we said this before, you should know this by now, that Advent just doesn't mean coming. It means, except for an intermission, we will get back to the original story. And this is very important for you to understand this. In God's perspective, as far as I can see, he had a plan for the earth. It talks about him having councils in the heavens before the earth, but then he decided to make humanity because he longed for the intimate fellowship and relationship with humanity. And that was his perfect will. The Garden of Eden was supposed to extend forever, you know, where there would be no work, there would be no sin, there would be no grief, there would be no pain, there'd be no shame. That's God's plan. But because of the garden and the fall, this is what he calls the intermission, you know, like commercials on TV. Because basically the intermission goes from the garden when they fell to the cross. And at the cross, the garden was reinstituted. And so now the intermission is over and we're back to the original play, that people can experience and know God like they knew in the garden. Now, most of us have not walked in the cool of the day every day with God, but we have access to God and you have special moments with God. That means that that intermission, that break, has been healed by the death of Jesus Christ. And this is very important when we talk about Advent, that we understand this, because that is what he talks about here. You know, we talk about the nativity, that means to be born, and Emmanuel, God with us. We celebrate this, but it is the celebration of God reinstituting his desire for you to be free, whole, and intimate with him. And so all of the Advents that we have are towards that purpose. You know, first we looked at the advent of hope. You know, that was the first week, and we have hope for salvation from sin. We have hope that the silence of God has been eliminated. Remember, there are 300 years between the Old and New Testament where God was not speaking to people, and that was over with the birth of Jesus Christ. And so they had this hope. Now God has visited us. That's what John the Baptist was all about. Come on out. Repent for your sins. Get ready, because God's doing something. He's back in a new way, in a powerful way. They didn't foresee what it was. Hope from being slaves to the world. You don't have to be under control of the world and its thoughts and systems. We have hope because we are a new creation. We have hope for the return of the King. Jesus is coming back. It's a reality. And then all of us have the hope of the resurrection and eternal life in the presence of God. Next, we came to the advent of peace. You know, the scripture talks about glory to God and peace on earth. This was a very powerful statement. you know, when God made this and the heavens were filled with the presence, because he was making this peace on earth politically, socially, interrelationship, self-relationship, spiritually, and emotionally. He wants peace in all of those areas. That is his desire. You know, humanity has a choice to either do God's desire or their own desire. So it isn't that God can't do this. I mean, he could eliminate all war, pain, disease in a second, but he's not doing it because he gave us free will and we have a choice. But the choice from God's perspective, when he said peace on earth, is to have peace in all of these. There should never be a conflict within you about who you are. If you're a Christian, you are a new creation, you're born again. That's what God wants, but we know how we struggle with that. And that hopefully over the years, as you become a Christian, you become healed more. I mean, I've seen people that have been Christians for 40, 50 years, and I am surprised that they've never changed. You know, their angers, their, you know, conceit, their narcissism, their hurt, their trauma, their pain, they just carried it for 40 years. And other people, nobody's perfect, but at least you see the people that are trying in the grace of God to become a better person. And that's what it is about. God is there to meet us, and God has given us everything, but we have to actualize it and participate in it so that we can be changed and transformed. So then we came to the advent of joy. Joy is probably one of the hallmarks of Christians and probably the most least observable of marks. You know, I don't know a lot of Christians that are joyful. You know, they may say they are. I mean, that's, I'm joyful, or joy to the world. But joy is that, it's not happiness. You can be sad and be joyful, but it's a condition of at rest and knowing that God is in control. And you see when people in their lives, God is in control or they're in control. And if they're in control, it can go good or it can go bad, you know. But even in God, it can go that way. But we have that assurance that God is there to help us. And so we have this joy, and it's, the Bible talks about the joy of our salvation is unspeakable. It's so great. None of us have ever fully understand salvation. We possess everything we need to participate in the divine nature to prepare our lives for a life of joy. We have joy that will take us from distractions, from time consumers, worldly attitudes, regretments, and unforgiveness. You know, probably one of the greatest needs in the body of Christ is to be forgiving. People take up offense against the world, against other people, and especially about Christians for some of the strangest things in the world. I mean, look at the end of your life when you're facing in the presence of God, and then look back and think of the things that really upset you. And they're not that important. They may be at the time, but to have that joy, God wants to realize that we are his. So he made covenants with us. He made the Abrahamic, the nomadic, Mosaic, and Davidic covenants with us. He, all along the line in this intermission, he made covenants, and he made these covenants because he wanted to lead humanity to being fulfilled and whole in his son. Each step was a covenant for a reason. But like God, when you look at God in the Trinity, it's always based on love, and it's always based on relationship. That's what it does. You know, I always kind of look at that, you know, when you ask Jesus, oh, Jesus, you're amazing. Jesus says, not me. It's the Father who's amazing. And the Father says, oh, no, it's not me. Look at my son. And the son says, oh, no, you know what? I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit. And then you go to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit says, wait a second, I'm here to reveal Jesus. And then you go back and forth because the relationship is whole, and it's always energizing, and it's complete. And that's what the covenant is about, because he wants to bring us into that covenant that they have. He makes other covenants, but it's for that reason. And so love in us, my wife always reminds me of this, is not just a concept, it's an action. Love is an action. It's not a feeling. Oh, I'm in love. You know, because people say this all the time. Oh, I love my dog. You know, I love chocolate. You know, I love winter. I love my wife. I love God. So it's a word, and it means a lot of different things. Greek have different words for it. But really, when love is alive and well, it's demonstrated in actions towards people and towards God. I mean, you can say you love God with all your mind, heart, and soul, but if you run your own life and make your own decisions and do everything on your own, you're really not showing love to God. And you can't hide that, but you can try. For God, though, it wasn't an action at first. See, we look at this like he sent, for God so loved the world, he gave his son. That wasn't an action that God did. It was because of who he was. He couldn't do anything else. We talked about this when we did John, that at the core of who God is love. Total love. And so we do actions to demonstrate how we feel. He does actions out of who he is, and that he doesn't have a choice, because he made these covenants. He longed for humanity to be whole and free, and every covenant brought closer, even the Ten Commandments and all of it, but none of them really did what he wanted, because he knew from the beginning there was only one way for him to bring people into wholeness, and that was through Jesus Christ. You can't do it through philosophy, you can't do it positive thinking. You can have very great results with all of that stuff, but when it comes down to a relationship with God in eternity, there is only one answer, and that is his son, Jesus Christ. And so he said, this is what I have to do, because I want you in the garden with me. I want you in that relationship where we walk in the cool of the day and there is no shame, and we're all healed and whole. And most of us know we're not whole and healed. But, you know, look at this idea, you know. People, when they're going to have a child, now nobody is in love with their child until it's born. You can be in love with the idea of having a child, but it changes dramatically when the child's born. When you hold that little baby, you see that little baby, everything changes. Now it's actions. See, before it was a concept, but now it is actions. Well, the same thing happened in the realm with Jesus. Before, God has always wanted to do this, but when the baby was born, now it becomes a whole different lifestyle, not only for his family and the church, but for us to this day, of how we act and see and do things, because this is real. And that's very important for us to understand, that it's love is an action, and it's based on who God is. The covenant had three really main parts to do. First of all, God had a covenant with the earth. It said, and through him to reconcile himself all things, whether on heaven and in earth. It's in Colossians. So God created the heavens and the earth, and it was fractured because of what happened in the garden. But God loves his creation, and so he wanted it reconciled. He wanted it to be made whole. We talked about this reconciliation in the cosmos. When Jesus died on the cross, let me tell you, we're not even aware of everything he did. I mean, there were things happening in the heavens and spiritual realms that we haven't figured out yet. But he said, I've reconciled heaven and earth. Everything has been reconciled to me. And that was to him a thing of joy. He really wanted. God doesn't hate creation. You know, we haven't been doing a good job with treating it right. But when he said it is good, he meant it was good. You know, and he didn't say, oh, well, now you messed it up and it's bad. No, he didn't say that. You know, we are supposed to be loving creation as God loves creation. So then God made a covenant with humanity. And it says, for God so loved the world. Isaiah 9:6 says this, that a child is born, a son is given, government shall be on his shoulders. He's a wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, and the increase of his government and peace will be no end. See, that was the covenant God made with people. He said, listen, I'm sending you a son. Realize who this son is. You know, this is not, you know, just another person. this is God in the flesh, but this is my plan for him, that he's the mighty counselor. He's has the governments on his shoulders. There is no end to his power. It may look like it sometimes that God isn't in control, but he is. So, and then finally, God made a covenant with individuals. You have everything you need to participate in the divine nature. You are a royal priesthood. You are a chosen race. You're saved by grace. You will live for eternity in the presence and acceptance of the most holy God. And it says in Revelation, he will lead them to springs of living water, and God will wipe every tear from their eyes. This is the covenant God made with humans, individuals. You know, he made a plan for the universe. He made a plan for salvation for the world, forgiving all the sins of the world. But he also says, I'm not just a generalist. I'm a specific person. Each one of you, I have the capacity, you don't, but I have the capacity to realize that you are my whole world. And I can do it to you, you, you. I can do it to billions of people. But I personally make you free. I personally make you whole. I personally make you a royal priesthood. See, we're always looking at other people, say, oh, I understand why God loves them. They're great. But look at that other person. They're terrible. No, God says, sorry, I made this covenant with you as an individual. It's a great thing. So the important part about this is that you understand that God is love. See, most of us, well, all of us, in fact, didn't have a perfect parents. You know, some of you had really bad parents. Some of you had good parents. Some of you didn't have parents, you know. But whatever it is, it formed an image in you. And one of the main things that has to happen to you is your ability has to come to a point where you see God as love and perfect. That he's not abusive, he's not a controller, he's not, you know, strict, he's not trying to, you know, ruin your life or cut out all your fun, but he is a loving, perfect God, perfect parent. And there's a lot of people that this is a concept for them. I mean, most people say, oh yeah, God is love. But see, what we talked about actions, if you have not had those actions in your life, you'll never advance fully in Christianity. You can't. Because if you don't see God as a loving person that is for you and wants to heal you and make you whole because of something that happened on earth, you're going to be very limited in who you can become. We have got to learn, God, show me who you are. Show me your love. Not for me, but let me have a right concept of who you are so I can be made whole. Because it's not about you. It isn't whether you deserve it or don't deserve it or have worked enough or not. It is about having a healthy concept of God. And there's a lot of people that don't because of what happened on earth or because it's still a concept and it's not an action. You can have a concept, God is perfect, and you can believe that. But if it doesn't really affect your life with actions, then it isn't really any beneficial to you. But God wants you to do this because God wants you to understand so you can be free. You know, now we come to the idea of this love that he has and the advent of love. He uses Philippians, or I'm going to use Philippians 2. It's probably one of Paul's greatest expressions of who Jesus is. To him, this was like what they call an opus magnus. But see, we see God as love, but we have to see Jesus as love because that's the person we relate to the most because we can read his story. We can visualize him in our mind. You know, you can read he did this and he did this. So for most people, their idea of God goes way over the board. You know, I mean, I see him as a big giant guy with a long white beard sitting on a throne. That's my concept. I mean, not that God isn't everywhere, but I don't have a concept. But Jesus is much easier for me to conceptualize because he was a human being and walked the earth. And there's a lot written about him, okay? But so now you have to see Jesus, what he did because of the advent of love. God sent him. That was God's advent of love to the earth. Not only loving the creation, loving the humanity, but loving the individual. Now Jesus comes in, and this is who we want. Paul wants you to understand this. So first of all, he said, being in the form of God. Now the Greek word here is a person at their very essence that is never changing. So Jesus never changed from deity. You know, we talk about the hypostatic union, but that's not, you know, that's fine. But Jesus wasn't the form of God. He was God. At the very core of who he was, the same thing we talk about love only, God only being able to do things out of love because he's love. Well, it's the same thing with Jesus. He is the same form, the same essence. God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. So they're always the same dealing with this love. So this form was something that he did. There's two words for the word form in Greek, morphe and schema. Morphe says that it never alters and schema is changing. So to conceptualize this, think about this. You will always be a human being. That's morphe. But schema, you change. I mean, you were a little baby and then you were a teenager, then you were an adult, and then you get old. So your body and who you are changes all the time, but the essence of being a human is always the same. So Jesus was the same way. He changed from a baby to a teenager to the Son of God. His changing stopped at the cross because he was glorified, but his essence never changes. Nothing that people could do to him affected him. You know, and the most powerful example is after he has been beaten and whipped and spit on and humiliated on the cross, which would have, you always know people when you put them in a pressure situation, who they really are comes out. You know, what came out of Jesus? Forgive them, for they know not what they do. That was all that could come out of him. Because there was nothing but love in him. So we talk about him being this way. It says he didn't think to be robbery to be equal with God. The Greek word here talks about not to snatch or grab. He didn't try to be like God. And this is a real secret for people in their walk. If you try to be like God, or try to be holy, or try to be righteous, you're going to fail. Because the way it works is if you empty yourself and let God fill you, then you become that. You want to be a powerful Christian? Let God lead you and fill you. Otherwise, if you're relying on your intelligence or your learning or your talent only, it'll be very limited because it isn't God filling you, it's you filling you. And This has to do with Jesus. He emptied himself. We talk about the kenosis doctrine here, and it really just talks about emptying himself and removing thing from a container. That's what the idea of the kenosis is, to pour something out, to empty it so it can be refilled. And so he gave up his glory and his power and his authority to become a human. He did that willingly because of his love. But he was still divine. And he took on the form of a servant. This is morphe. He took the essential form. And what we mean was, you know, we talked about morphe earlier. His essence of being deity didn't change. But he took on the form of a slave or a servant. See, he wasn't playing at it. You know, the Greek gods, you know, when you read mythology, they come down and they take shapes and forms and books, and they play with humanity. So they're playing at being human. But see, Jesus didn't play to be human. He didn't that's one of the things they talk about, was he real or just appear this way? He was real. He was a real human being. He was a baby. He had all the functions and all the ups and downs that humans have. Because it wouldn't have worked if he just played at it. But he became a human like you, so that he could give his life for you. So it's very important for you to understand that. And it says, his life was lived out in love for three reasons. First, to seal our salvation by the cross. That was his main function. He knew when he came that there was a price to be paid, because he knew he was the lamb slain from the foundation of the earth. He knew what the cost would be. Secondly, he taught the truth of God out of his love. He said, one, I will die for them. Two, I'm going to teach them what God says. Because he said this, remember? It's not me. I only speak what the Father speaks. And then thirdly, he shared with us, well, let me go back, I just missed a point, that the truth was how we could be free, whole, and what I'm talking about tonight, the original story that God wants us to be. And the third way was, he showed his love, was to demonstrate it in his life. He's a living example. But remember, he is a living example that you have to understand was a human. He said, I do nothing of myself. I only do what I see the Father doing. He also said, everything I shall do, you shall do, and even greater. So he's not, if he was playing at being a human because he was God, then you wouldn't have to do anything. Because you'd say, well, I can't play at being human. I'm not God. But he said, no, I'm a human being like you. I breathe. I cry. I laugh. I have the same struggles you do. But in this, by being obedient to God, I can live this life that is an example for you on how to treat people, how to change things, and how to glorify God. So that was the third reason for his love. And so by living these principles, God honored him, it says at the end of this scripture. He gave him a name above all names. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. Everybody will worship him. And everybody will know that he is Lord. Why? Because he was obedient to the Father to do his will. So the final thing, we have the advent of love by God, the advent of love by Jesus. So the final thing is the advent of love by us. What does God want you to do? God wants you to love him with the same love that God had for Jesus. John 17 says, I will make you known to them, and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me might be in them and that I myself may be in them. God is challenging you to love Jesus at the same level that God loves Jesus. That's amazing. He's expecting us to be one in the body and one in him at the same level the Trinity is. That's unbelievable. And when you understand that, then you start learning, whoa, I can't do that. But God can. I don't have to start trying to get along with everybody. I don't have to try to be holy. I don't have to try to be righteous. I need to let God work that in my heart and in my life so that I live it, because it's such a powerful thing. Jesus wants you to love those in need. If anyone shuts their eyes to the cry of the poor, they will cry too and will not be answered. Let me read a scripture to you. I know I'm going over a little bit. This is a very powerful scripture that I think answers this whole thing. It's in 1 John. Therefore, do not be surprised, brothers and sisters, if the world hates you. We know that we have crossed over from death to life because we love our fellow Christians. The one who does not love remains in death. Everyone who hates their fellow Christians is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life residing in them. We have come to know love by this, that Jesus laid down his life for us. We ought to lay down our lives for our fellow Christians. But whoever has this world's possessions and see their fellow Christians in need and shuts off the compassion against them, how can the love of God be in such a person? Little children, do not love with word or with tongue, but in deed and truth. And by this we will know that we are of the truth, and we will convince our conscience in the presence of the Lord. This is a powerful thing, folks. You know, I've noticed during COVID, you know, there's a lot of falling out with COVID and all this stuff. But one of the things I've noticed in a lot of places, not here, every church has this, people have become more self-concerned. You know, now health, I'm not talking about health-wise. It just seems like whatever was in them is starting to come out, and it's not a good thing. It's not loving and caring for one another. It's not how can I support you? How can I be one? How can we change the world? But it's more like drawing back into, you know, like hiding out in your house because you don't want to get sick. That's a fine thing. But when we do that emotionally and we do that compassionately for other people, and now he's not talking about if you have things, you know, if you have 12 pairs of socks and you see somebody with no socks, you got to go give them half of yours. He's not talking about that, because he's talking about, you know, having to deal with what is emotional, what is psychological, what is spiritual, whatever the need is. If somebody's in need, you should try to meet that need. They may need a hug. I mean, that may be a simple thing, but, you know, or a handshake or a note or a phone call. See, it's the idea that love is an action, not a concept. You know, that's the difference. Our advent of love, God has already proved his advent of love by sending his son. And his son has already proved his advent of love by what he did, what he said, and how he secured our eternity. Now it moves to an advent of love by us, because the world will only see the love of God. Now, we all see it, and we all know it, because we know God. But somebody who's out there who doesn't know God, the only way they'll ever see the love of God is through you. In actions, compassion, love. It isn't going out and just feeding people or doing that. Those are all great things. But it's an attitude of the heart. It's being willing at any time to help people. You know, C.S. Lewis says something about, you know, it's easy to love mankind, but a lot of times it's an excuse not to care for an individual, you know, and we're good at that. So, you know, we really need to be part of love. Okay, so it's emotional, psychological. Loving everybody in general may be an excuse for loving nobody in particular. Jesus wants us to love him first, for sure. Where your treasure is, your heart will be. God is love. Jesus is love. He fixed the intermission. And he wants us to know that we are called to love God with all our mind, heart, and soul, to live a life like the loving Savior did, and to love our neighbor in all our ways. You know, it says to love your neighbor as yourself. And we've talked about this. You can't love your neighbor if you don't love yourself. If you're broken, all your relationships are going to be broken. You got to be healed. It's not that you're perfect, or none of us are perfect. But how can you honestly say you're not of value when Jesus gave his life for you? I mean, this is on a whole different scale. I mean, God is saying, listen, you may think bad of yourself. You may have had a tough life. You may have nobody hugged you. I don't know what's wrong. But don't ever think that I did this out of pity for you, or I do it for some and not for some. I am perfect knowledge, perfect power, perfect love. So when I tell you that you are new creation, the old things have passed away, I am God. You have no right to tell me I'm wrong. But you've got to learn to let me deal with you so you realize that I'm right. Because God wants you to be healed. So the covenant now of love is that we show the world how loving God is by what we do, what we think, and how we act it out. Let's pray. God, it is amazing to think that your covenants and your advent was for us. So long ago, you birthed this idea of having intimate relationships with humans. And that intimate relationships with human goes down through thousands of years to us sitting here. You still long for us to be free and whole. You still long for us to be at peace and know joy and hope. You long for us to love one another like you love Jesus. So help us to celebrate, to live this, and be transformed by the renewing of our mind and the healing of who we are. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. So now we have sharing of praises, I guess. I'm looking at my thing. So does anybody have anything they want to share? Raise their hand. I think Vivian had her hand up. And up here.
Hi, I'm Vivian, and my daughter's been going through a pretty rough patch the last 6 weeks. 4 trips to the emergency room, 2 surgeries, last one being Friday. And I just want to thank the doctors. I think that they, hopefully, this will be the last of the complications, and that hopefully everything will be well. And just want to praise the good medical care and doctors that we do have available to us, and very thankful. And the Lord, of course, of course. Amen. Above all, the Lord.
Every year at Christmas, my chiropractor does the thing he calls the basket brigade, where he takes food donations and money donations to buy food for people in need. Yesterday, I had the privilege of delivering some of those baskets of food, and it humbled me beyond belief. And by the time I delivered a couple, I had no tears left, because those people were so very grateful for a basket of food. And I thank God every day for the blessings we have.
Amen. Anyone else? Okay, is there any Zoomers? Looking for a signal here through the little window. No Zoomers. You're up.
Okay, so ending on that note, let us close today, Sunday, with singing Away in a Manger. We are celebrating Christmas this week, so let us remember that all of this is because that babe was born in that manger. So you're welcome to stay and join us.
I'm going to go out this door, and yeah, I expect all of you to go out that door, because there was a lot of very special treats left over from last night that I know you're going to want to indulge in. So remember, next Friday night is Christmas Eve. It's just a night to celebrate as a family. And I just have one prayer request. You know, we take care of Dan Breeding, and last night after the thing was over, Linda went over, and he couldn't walk, and he was laying on the floor, and we had to carry him upstairs. And so I don't know what's going on. So just if you can remember Dan, I would appreciate it. So let's pray. God, we are grateful for this season. We're grateful for your son. We celebrate life and truth and freedom. We celebrate you being part of us and leading us. And we look forward to a new year. Even greater things, because you said from glory to glory you're leading us. So let us go out, let us bless one another, and we thank you in your name. Amen.